Good morning. Today is Sunday, June 14th, and it's about 9:10 a.m. here in Pasadena, California. And here is the update for the past week. So we are getting offers to help with the content creation, as mentioned on the last update. Again, if you're interested in creating any content, doesn't matter what platform it's on, just in your areas of interest, it's going to help build the awareness of what we're doing, which will support, of course, the market. And if you have a stake in it, your stake in the market. So if you're interested in that, in having a voice, basically a subject matter expert, and you have a particular platform or platforms you'd like to produce various content for, please send an email to support@asmfree.com. Again, support@asmfree.com. So I'll also be talking to Jeff and his team, I mentioned this last time, about a content creation plan focused around podcasting, interviews, and that sort of thing. Once we get a little bit more structure around how we're going to work the public relations campaign, we're looking right now at a possible first mention of the first fundraising deal for a league this summer. So awaiting final confirmation on whether that's going to take place or not with this particular league. Nothing further to say until that's totally finalized. So once that's figured out, then we can go back to Hero Club and their network, not just for the team at C-Suite and Hero Club to create supplemental PR around this, but also to activate other members who may want to help and do that. So first, so in summary, if you are interested in creating content for your own, to build your own audience, please write a message to support@asmfree.com and know that we are working on a larger plan. Once we fix the schedule for the first fundraise, we need to build the PR plan around that. So once that contracting is done, then we'll build out the PR plan, and that's when I'll go back to the network built inside of Hero Club and C-Suite, which, by the way, it's almost up to 2,000 contacts, LinkedIn contacts, and it's growing organically at this point. Okay, so all this talk about, I'll get to the bigger issue and the close, all the things that are going on right now. They really come down to, this particular point was about defunding the police. I don't think that's a reasonable thing. I think that's an extreme position. But the idea here is lack of access to opportunity. These are all parts of the same problem. Talking about defunding the police and those kinds of things, those are all attacking the symptoms, not the actual source. The source is equal access to opportunity, which is, that's the driving force behind what we're all about here, what this whole thing is all about in creating sports markets. Okay, so Delta, I use Delta as a thumbnail sketch for the airline business just because they've really been around a long time. And you don't hear a whole lot about them. They're kind of a quiet force in the airline industry. I prefer them when possible because their service tends to be better, but they also tend to be higher in price. So if you look at them to kind of get a gauge of where the airline business is, they're cutting 80% of their domestic schedule and 90% of their international schedule. That's consistent with what's been said over the past few months. It's just interesting to me that it's continuing to be at the same numbers. So that tells me that the projection for return of demand just isn't there, even going forward several months into this. Pay attention to that. The CARES Act, which was the $3 trillion recovery bill that includes all the unemployment stuff and all of the SBA loan stuff. It also has a increase of the deduction limit from 60% of your adjusted gross income to 100%. That was a change made that I noticed in reading through some of the line items, the headline line items of the package. So if you contribute to any 501c3, which we are also, that's what we are, it's a 501c3, then, so it's not specific to us, it's to any 501c3, the deductibility has been almost doubled from the previous statutory limits during this time. So that will apply to any funds you contribute to us as well if you're a U.S. Person or entity under those rules. IBM is backing off of facial recognition technology. I've long said that IBM, again, another bellwether that you don't hear a lot about, but pay attention to their activities and their public messaging. This is all coming on the, in the heat that's been generated by the Floyd killing, the protests, all the things going on that's I'm sure everybody's very well aware of. I think it's a big signal because IBM is a big government contractor. This is a change of policy at the corporate level to support basically the surveillance state idea. So pay attention to that. I think that's a big thing. Oral argument is next week on the Wire Act case, where it stands right now. So we're going to, of course, be paying very close attention to this. As a refresher, the Wire Act is still a nationwide federal prohibition against online. It's not against online gambling specifically. It was the 1961 Wire Act, Kennedy administration anti-corruption statute, was focused around telephones to communicate bet information across the state lines. That law is still in place, and the wires are still interpreted to mean the internet. So this is the core. This is the federal issue that still says that online gambling is illegal, okay, nationwide, in spite of all the public messaging to the contrary regarding PASPA. PASPA is not enabling legislation. PASPA did only one thing, and that is to remove the federal prohibition for the decision making to be made at the state level. That is all, okay? So you must have enabling legislation, which is still only a handful of states, less than 20 states against 50 states plus DC and territories. So it's not there on the state level in less than 2/5 of the states. It is still under the Federal Wire Act, which is a 100% prohibition. And this oral argument is next week. Justice Department has not backed off of this case. This is somewhat machinations by Sheldon Adelson in Vegas to protect that turf. Frankly, that battle between Vegas on the ground and the online gambling business is to our benefit because they're fighting over the turf. Adelson is afraid it's going to be taken away from Vegas, which is a totally valid concern. But so is trying to twist behind the scenes to put the squeeze on them. The effect, of course, is beneficial to us because if this is this matter is upheld and it's said that online gambling is in fact still prohibited, then that is going to freeze. You're going to see a huge change in the direction in terms of the expansion of sports gambling. And it's too hard to say at this point. There's a lot at stake, obviously, but I would put the odds at better than even, given the players and given the condition of the Supreme Court. It's better than even chance. It's not going to go their way. So pay attention to that. There will be a lot of chatter next week on this case, I'm sure. NASCAR banning the rebel flag. This is probably the single biggest. I know the NFL kneeling thing. But this is probably the single biggest change in policy from a corporate operator as relates to this clash of cultures that appears to be happening. Frankly, it looks to me like somebody's trying to incite a race war. That's what it looks like from my viewpoint. But the fact that NASCAR is pulling this down, this is a huge... It's too much for me to really say. It happened very recently, last few days. So I'm just going to leave that alone for now. I'm sure you're going to see this play out in a very big way over the coming weeks and months, especially as we get close to the election. Hats off to NASCAR Right Move. This is the wrong. All this stuff about history. Look, I grew up in the South. My high school flag is the Confederate flag. The Pineville Rebels, just look it up. So don't preach to me about the rebel flag. I grew up in the South. I know what it stands for, okay? Louisiana, Mississippi, Arkansas, okay. Those are all my relatives, okay? So it's nonsense. It is utter nonsense to say that it doesn't represent what it represents. It's absolutely a racist symbol. That is flat. Okay, so especially in the year 2020, you know, as a child, yeah, it was all Confederacy and, you know, historical and all that, and, you know, the Civil War and all that. But as it very quickly became obvious to me, even as a teenager, what it was really about. There were even issues about that in my school, in my high school, about the use of that, even though it was their school flag, which is kind of incredible. Don't lecture me on that. I grew up in that. I was bused. I was bused into an all-black school. I never had a day's issue with it. So I'm speaking from experience, not from watching television. All right, so big deal. I'm going to have hard to measure the repercussions right now. So Nike, so the NFL reverse position on kneeling. That's huge. Again, too much to get into here. Just suffice to say that between NFL and NASCAR, Nike was already there. Starbucks going there. So you have companies that are now getting very political. This isn't going to change. Okay, the age of the activist CEO. I've been like this from the beginning. This is the trend. This is the way it's going. People vote with their money. It counts. Don't talk to me about being politically neutral. I'm not politically neutral. I've never been politically neutral. Nobody is politically neutral, okay? To say that you're politically neutral is a lie, okay? What you're really doing when you do that is you're being a coward, okay? If you're a business director, you're being a coward and you're being a pure greedy asshole capitalist that doesn't care about what the money actually does, okay? That is not a paradigm that is going to work in the future. It is not going to work, okay? The upcoming generation, millennials and even older than that, that's not how they view the world. So the winners are going to be the people who have a spine, okay, that have a spine and attach their values to their business. And people that don't want to subscribe to that can take their money somewhere else, okay? That's fine. I mean, there are plenty of companies that have been doing that for a long time, but this is now big, okay? Nike, NFL, NASCAR, Starbucks, that's, you're not getting around that. This is the way things are going. So that's the way it is. And that's the way it will be. Starbucks, okay, 400 stores closing. Huge, because it's, again, premium brand, tends to survive. People will prioritize their Starbucks coffee over other things. So this is a measurement of the broader economy. Again, weak, far weaker than it's being claimed with this bogus jobs report. Okay, look, this age of upside down, this is absolutely insane. Unemployment claims, okay? Continuing unemployment claims. That means that people are still reauthorizing. You have to make a sworn statement every week or 2 weeks, depending on where you are. You have to make a sworn statement under perjury that a series of conditions remain true in order to continue getting the benefits. So there is no way whatsoever that a survey, which is what the jobs report was based on, survey is going to be more accurate than a sworn statement. There's just absolutely no way. People will lie at the drop of a hat on a survey because of their egos. They're not going to tell you the real condition of their job because they're ashamed or whatever. But you put them on a government form that says, I swear under penalty of perjury that I'm going to be thrown in jail or be fined, etc., for a statement, and that the number of people who are willing to lie under that situation goes down drastically, okay? So we have 44 million unemployment claims. The job force, the workforce, look it up yourself. It's about 160 million. That's 25% all day long. It's 25% all day long. Why does this matter? Because it's a political game that's being played here to try to sway public opinion. The more sinister part of this is it's going to affect policy in terms of recovery programs that are put in place that people still need. So if you misrepresent that data, then policies like whether they continue the unemployment benefits, the enhanced portion of it, or any other type of recovery program is based upon this type of information. So getting this right is absolutely critical to making the right policy decisions. And presently, they're not going to make the right policy decisions if they don't get the numbers right. The number is 25%, okay? It's been underreported by about half. It's actually, if you watch the reporting, they're notching it up a little bit. Now it's up to almost 20%. Look, it's 25%, okay? You need to base your policy decisions off of that, or you're going to make mistakes, and you're going to be right back up against the wall again because people are not going to be able to pull out of this crash with what's being done in terms of the aid packages. Full stop, okay? Casino stocks took a beating last week. Well, for obvious reasons, the restart in Vegas is garbage, okay? You can go through go from the people who are obviously hyping it to they're going to the most crowded places at the moment that the casino starts operation to film the crowd at the door. But just the walk around pictures, you know, through the airports and through car rental agencies and through just on the street, there's obvious the foot traffic is next to zero, and it's all locals, okay? These are not people flooding into the airports. Makes no sense. Just look at the picture. Does it make sense to sit there with an alcoholic beverage in your hand playing baccarat or poker or roulette or craps with a plexiglass shield and a face mask on, a medical surgical mask on? This is not a priority for people, and to that public messaging, that symbolism makes no sense. It's two dissimilar things stuck together. Two opposites, basically, put together. So I guess everybody was waiting to see whether those numbers were really going to be bad like they were in Macau, and they're really bad. So, I mean, okay. Barstool store. Okay, so the day trade... This is something we've been looking at for a while. Okay, so in the battle between bet and invest, and I've said this for many years, there's no way to win that on an equivalent topic. You know, invest in a home, bet on a home. Invest in a piece of land, bet on a piece of land. There's no way around it. So there was no such thing as invest in sports performance. Okay, that's what we have. Bets are bets on sports performance. We have invest in sports performance. That, there's no way to beat that if that's a legitimate thing. And our product, okay, we're going to prove it mathematically, okay, and otherwise, is that, okay, is a legitimate investment in sports performance. If you compete with me, if I exist, you're going to have a problem. So, what the guys are doing in the gambling business, and yes, they know we're here. There's no question about that. They are trying to move the goalposts. They're trying to change the definition of day trading, change the definition of trading. Alper was keen to this long before I was. They're going to try to change the definition of investment. That's what they're trying to do. Okay? Barstool Story Sports, Sports Story came out about day trading, trying to turn sports gamblers into day traders and how they're suddenly finding themselves in the stock market. Yeah, okay, we're already there. Okay, nice try. You're not going to change the rules, and you're not going to steal the only model that's been proven to work after nearly, well, operationally for more than 15 years, conceptually nearly 20 years. to clarify those numbers, we went online with the beta in 03. We went with the live market in 04. Okay, so in the 16 years of time, nobody's been able to put together a model that works other than this one. So if we're there, we are, and we have been. We've been there longer than Daily Fantasy's been out there. You're going to have a problem if you're dealing with our proposition on its face. So they're going to try to move the goalposts. And I see this first story as an attempt at that, to try to confuse people with the idea that trading stocks and investing in bets or trading and investing are trading and betting are the same thing as investing. Not true. It doesn't pass a sniff test, and you might have been able to gaslight people into thinking that's the case if we did not exist and haven't existed for more than a decade, nearly 20, if you go back to concept. So you're going to have a problem. We're not going to let you get away with that, and the public is not going to buy that once we stand up and say, wait, hold on a second. That doesn't make any sense. Okay, uptick in sports risk hits. So one of the Google alert searches that I have and have been watching for a long time, more than a decade, is sports risk, mainly to look at the sports risk index coverage, if anything gets mentioned about that or anything in dealing with sports risk. So there's been a significant uptick in the searches for the term sports risk. I think that's obvious, the pandemic, and I talked about insurance last time, not being able to get pandemic insurance. So that tells me that the market is waking up to there's a risk problem. There's a risk problem, and that's why the restarts are also a big issue, as talked about last time. Diversity statement, so you're going to start to see more of that. I'm not going to get into where we stand on that and putting one of those out, but you're definitely going to see a lot of that. League chatter about making fans stockholders. That also, I think that came from the same day trading. Actually, this is from something else. This is from an internal communication that we got regarding a league fundraise we're working on. So one of the, and it was a public mention of just this idea of making fans stockholders. Yeah, we got that. That's our idea back from almost 20 years ago. So we agree with that 100%. Interesting on the Hero Club huddle on Friday, which I sent to all of our program members. There's a gentleman there that is involved in online gambling, specifically in horse racing, and actually has is responsible for building the system that you see in all the racetracks. He asked on Friday whether or not any of the people that have online businesses saw any change on the protests. So my answer to that is actually yes, and I mentioned this on the last video update, pretty sure, that once the protests broke out, the volume, for the first time, literally the first time, all the way back to the beta in 2003, the volume nearly evaporated. Not to zero, but very, very close, and I've never seen that. This is the same thing that this gentleman saw related to online gambling, and a very slow clawback or recovery of activity, which is attention. So this is consistent with my hypothesis, which is that this is a major, societal, social event thing that's happening here, to the point that it's distracting people that much. That's what it tells me. So it is the biggest thing that has happened since, in the last, I would say, 15 years. That's how I would apply the data that I see and the data that was corroborated by this call on Friday and the data that I see in the public domain in terms of stories. So it's a big deal. Half of all oil companies are on the edge of failure in the next 12 months, including Chesapeake Energy, which was a huge all-star fracking, babe in the market, so to speak. That's, again, the condition of things. Half, again, goes back to you lose half the economy, half, half, half. You're going to see half, half, half all over the place. Okay, so I've really been trying to gather all of this, what's happening right now. It's all part of the same thing. You know, Black Lives Matter, the pandemic, results, things that are happening in the economy from that. These are all symptoms of a common problem. The common problem is a lack of access to opportunity, okay? That's the source of it, okay? All of this stuff that is happening is just symptoms, and at the extreme edges, things bubbling out that are beneath the surface. The real issue is lack of access to opportunity, and that's what ASM is all about. That's what sports markets are all about. It's taking this natural desire to, take your passion about sports, apply your knowledge to it, and be able to profit from it. And then the ecosystem that builds up around that for not just, in people individually to be able to build businesses around that, but just an industry creator, okay? Sports industry, the creation of a sports financial industry that the public can participate in, and everything that means, that is a, look, I'll go one further. I've said this before, but it's just becoming clear to me that a solution this large is what is needed. So, it's the same message, okay, over and again, but the moment in time just continues to reveal itself, clearer and clearer and clearer, that we need to put this online. So the key to all of that, is the successful fundraise of the first league and the ability to publicize that. And everything that we're doing is driving towards that, okay? Content creation, outreach, responding to people that have inquired, working towards that. So if you support our work through any sort of contribution to a program, then that's what you're contributing towards. And again, if you do that, it's gone from 60% limit to 100% limit of your adjusted gross income because of the CARES Act. So your funds and any other things that you do, content creation, all of that stuff, are toward putting in a fix for this fundamental, foundational problem that we have and a lack of access to opportunity. And since sports touches everything, and that's where you insert the opportunity. So sports markets solve the problem. Sports markets are the cure, bottom line. So thank you for your time. Have a great day, rest of the weekend, and stay safe with your family.